Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for coming today. Welcome to the Leopard at Des Artistes. Welcome to the book launch for An Affair with Beauty, The Mystique of Howard Chandler Christy, The Magic of Youth. It's the first book in what will be a trilogy on the epic life of the American painter Howard Chandler Christy. And many of you have been here before, but for those of you who have not been here before, you should note that Christy lived in this building for many years, from 1915 until 1952. And of course, he's painted these paintings. Now, many people may call them murals, but if Christy was here, he would correct me, or correct those who would call them murals, because they are not permanently affixed to the walls. They are paintings. Well, Christy painted these in 1934. The restaurant has been around since 1916, when the building was erected. And in 1934, during the Great Depression, the revenues of the restaurant were slumping. And then-owner Frank China consulted Christy, because he knew that Christy painted beautiful women and could do something to spice things up a bit. And Christy had this brilliant idea of painting nude women. It was very scandalous, sensational at the time, but you know, it was during that era, pre-code era almost, and of course the Ziegfeld Follies were in their full glory, and so this is what he came up with. In September of 1934, Christy signed a contract with Mr. China where he would paint 12 paintings, four large ones and eight smaller ones, for the grand sum of $2,000. Seems like a small sum. Well, when they were unveiled on October 17th, 1934, the room was packed full of people, and it was a star-studded crowd. There was aviatrix Amelia Earhart, as well as her publisher husband, George Putnam. There was the Postmaster General, James A. Farley, and his family. There was Mr. and Mrs. Walter P. Chrysler, and many more. Of course, Christy was good friends with Babe Ruth. He saw these murals. And also the great humorist Will Rogers. When he walked in the restaurant with Christy one day, he looked around and he said, "Howard, you don't need Hollywood. You've got it all right here." Well, the murals were very popular and the restaurant's revenues quickly surged. Christy was paid a lump sum of $250 with a remaining balance of $1,750 paid in installments based upon the performance of the restaurant. So popular that in 1942 he did more murals, and those murals you don't see here today. Why is that? What happened to those murals? Well, they were here until the 1970s. In 1976, then-owner Romeo Sterlini had a dispute with the cooperative apartment, the Hotel Des Artistes. The cooperative apartment said that these murals were theirs, and Romeo Sterlini said, "No, they're mine. They were made for the restaurant." Ultimately, they settled the dispute. Romeo took half of the murals, and the remaining murals remained here in the restaurant. Those murals perished, the ones that he took, apparently in a fire in Florida. Well, as elegant and sophisticated as these murals are, you wonder, who was the man who actually painted them? What was his life like? Well, Christy had very humble beginnings. They began in 1872, January 10th to be exact, in a log cabin in Morgan County, Ohio. He was born to the son of a Civil War veteran, slightly hard of hearing, named Francis Marion Christy, and his wife, Mary Matilda Bone Christy. And at the age of three, he moved from that log cabin north about 25 miles to Muskingum County, where his father bought a farm for about $2,300. It wasn't just any farm, it was 200 feet up on a bluff overlooking the Muskingum River. And Christy, a bit like Mark Twain, would sit on that bluff and watch the steamboats go up and down. And he wanted to be on that steamboat. And he dreamt of painting big pictures of big things. And he wanted to go off to far places. So he did just that. In 1890, he came right here to New York, studied at the Art Students League, then located on East 23rd Street, and loved painting in that studio and with the teachers there. But he ran out of money. He felt like a failure. And he went back to Ohio, to his roots. And he decided he's going to come back to New York and he's going to do great things. And so in Ohio, he worked on the farm, collected berries, and painted mussel shells. In 1891, he came back to New York and quickly became the star pupil of the premier portrait painter of the time period, William Merritt Chase. Well, Chase thought very highly of him, and after a period of 3 years, around 1895, Christy realized that he would make more money painting commercial illustrations than he would painting pots or flowers. And so he told William Merritt Chase that that's what he wanted to do. And Chase didn't speak to him for about 5 years after that. Well, history has a way of changing people, and it changed Howard Chandler Christy. In 1898, America went to war with Spain, the Spanish-American War, and Christy decided he wanted to go down to Cuba to cover, as a commercial illustrator, the battles there. And he did that, just that. Went down to Tampa, got on board the SS Yucatan, and guess who else was on that boat, the SS Yucatan? Teddy Roosevelt! And Christy became quick friends with Teddy Roosevelt. Well, Christy ended up in Cuba in the Battle of Santiago, painted the horrors of warfare, painted the scenes of men in uniform, and decided that he was going to come back. Of course, it was a very short war. It was ended in August of 1898. He returned to New York, and this time he fell in love. He fell in love with a woman by the name of Maybelle Gertrude Thompson, a Washington, D.C. debutante who was in New York starring in a play for Augustine Daly, and Christy eventually married her. At that time, he decided he had enough of painting men in uniform. The publishers of the time period thought that's what they wanted, that's what people wanted, and Christy, of course, said, I've had enough painting men in uniform, I want to do something completely different. And so what he decided to do was create the modern paradigm of feminine beauty, something that rivaled the Gibson girl. It was called the Christy girl. And of course, he modeled that mostly on his wife, Maybelle, at the time period. And Maybelle became the face of the Christy girl on the covers of major magazines in the early part of the 20th century. It was said that her face was on more magazines from 1900 to 1909 than any other woman available. Well, the Christy girl took off. There are Christy girl postcards, there are Christy girl dresses, there are Christy girl calendars and gift books. There are even entire musicals named after the Christy girl. And of course, Howard Chandler Christy became a rock star at the time period. Well, as time progresses, World War I breaks out, and of course, the government needs a way to compel men to fight a war they didn't want to fight. So they rely upon Christy and his colleagues, what I call the illustrators of beauty. Charles Dana Gibson, Harrison Fisher, J.C. Leyendecker, and James Montgomery Flagg to create these wonderful World War I posters. I'm sure many of you have seen them. You probably don't know the story behind those posters. And of course, Christy becomes more of a rock star painting these wonderful posters. Well, during that time period, actually a little bit prior to that, I should say, Christy and his wife had a falling out. He, of course, was becoming sort of a typical artist. He drank too much, and he decided he wanted to go back to Ohio, go back to his roots. So he returned to Ohio in 1908, built a mansion overlooking the Muskegon River, where his family owned a farm, and did a lot of his greatest illustrations, primarily for Cosmopolitan magazine during that time period. Meanwhile, his wife, Maybelle, was in New York, and they had a daughter, Natalie. She was born in 1899. Well, Christy wanted Natalie to stay in Ohio. Maybelle wanted Natalie to stay in New York. At one point, Christy retains Natalie in Ohio, and Maybelle files suit in the Muskegon County Circuit Court. The case of Christy versus Christy became the largest, most highly publicized child custody battle Ohio, if not America, had ever seen up to that point. And of course, all the details came out, that Christy took liberties with his models, and Maybelle drank too much. Christy was committed to an insane asylum. Well, guess who got little Natalie at the end of that 6-day trial? Howard Chandler Christy. How did he do that? Well, you gotta read the second book in the trilogy, you'll find out. Well, ultimately, Maybell stays back in New York. She's very angry at Christy. And Christy, of course, continues to make lots of money doing these great illustrations. And he comes back to New York from time to time to meet his editors and his publishers. And it was in the spring of 1912 that he meets, perhaps, one of the best models he ever had. It's a woman by the name of Nancy Palmer. She was born in Amsterdam, New York, around 1893, maybe 1892. I don't know, she lied about her age. And they meet through his connection with Charles Dana Gibson. Nancy is tired of working in a cigar factory, the Schwartz Cigar Factory in Poughkeepsie, New York. She has a letter of introduction to the famed illustrator Charles Dana Gibson, who has studios right down the street here at Carnegie Hall. She takes a train, meets Gibson in his studios. Gibson says, you know, you're wonderful, but I can't use you. I only use a model maybe once, twice, and that's it. But I know someone who can, someone who's been through a lot. Of course, he doesn't really say that, but he knows what Christie's been through and how difficult it is for him to get a model. And so Gibson introduces Nancy to Howard Chandler Christie when they're in New York. Well, Nancy is completely smitten with Christy, and Christy is becoming smitten with Nancy. And he invites Nancy to come back with him to his mansion in Ohio. Now, during that time period, 1912, that was a little risque. You know, she goes to the home, a mansion, of a man she never met before, unchaperoned, miles away, and of course, she doesn't quite know his past. And so that's where this first book picks up, when Nancy meets Christy in 1912. Well, ultimately, by 1919, Maybell and Christy get a divorce. Maybell remarries within a month. And within a few months thereafter, Christy and Nancy marry. Well, by 1921, Nancy is seeing the writing on the walls. She's getting a little older, the models are getting a little younger, and she thinks, perhaps we ought to give up this illustration business. And so by 1921, Howard vows that he's giving up illustration for good. He really doesn't. He still stays in it. He still has contracts with William Randolph Hearst and the Cosmopolitan, but he kind of limits his illustration work. And so by 1921, he's doing mostly portraiture. And he starts off big by painting some of the big men of the day, including Warren Harding, President Harding, and then continues on with Calvin Coolidge. And of course, this creates great publicity for him. Everyone wants to be painted by him. They want him in his hand and his brush to immortalize their faces. And during that time period, the 1920s, I would say Christy was the premier, the most popular painter in America, bar none. Everyone knew who he was. Everyone wanted to be painted by him. And of course, he could command fairly large prices. $20,000 to $30,000, people would pay him. That's 1920s currency for him to immortalize them. Of course, by the 1930s, even during the Great Depression, he was still commanding between $2,500 and $4,500. That's the equivalent of $25,000 to $45,000 today. And he painted some of the greatest people during that time period. Amelia Earhart, Douglas MacArthur, Eddie Rickenbacker, presidents from Teddy Roosevelt all the way through Harry Truman, congressmen, senators. If you go to the U.S. Capitol has 7 paintings on canvas by Christie, including the largest painting ever done in the Capitol, 20 by 30 feet. It's called The Scene of the Signing of the U.S. Constitution. He completed that in 1939 and 1940. And today, it's interesting to pass by that painting. Because if you look closely, I will guarantee it, you will see Christy's face in that painting. He painted himself in that painting. And I leave it to you to find out where is Christy's face. But he did that at age 68, 20 by 30 feet. Well, Christy lived here, as I mentioned earlier, from 1915 to 1952. He died on March 3rd, 1952. And the first book you'll read that day that he died, his wife, Nancy, went out to run a bank errand, and she was late coming home. She wanted to get him his favorite flower, hyacinth. It was spring, and when she returned home, Howard was deceased and died of a heart attack. Now, this is what she told the reporters that day. She said that she went out to run a bank errand. That's true. And she was late coming home. That's true. She said that a woman by the name of Mrs. Walter Timmons was taking care of Nancy. That wasn't true. And so she created an illusion. That's something that, well, one of the many themes, I should say, that presents itself in this book. What is truth and what is illusion? Because even in these murals, there is a lot of illusion, as it was in Christie's life. And how did Christy die? Well, it seems that everyone wants to know that question. My own daughter, who's 14 years of age, keeps telling me, "Daddy, how did Christy die?" And I tell her, "You'll have to read the book." So when the first book came out, she went right to the end. She goes, "It's not there, Daddy." And I said, "Yeah, you gotta read the third book." And then you'll find out. Well, the story of Christy's life isn't a story about an artist and his art. It's really about the changing of America through the first half of the 20th century. A man who influenced it and a man who captured it. It's a rags to riches epic of an ordinary man, because that's how he considered himself, but living in remarkable times and possessing an extraordinary talent, the power to see his beauty and immortalize youth. He had fame, he had fortune, he had beautiful models. But in the end, he discovers something much greater, and that, I believe, ladies and gentlemen, is his true legacy. And you may ask, what could be better than fame, fortune, and beautiful models? Well, you'll have to read the trilogy. Before I go, I want to introduce an extraordinary woman with an exceptional voice, Pamela Almond. She has come here today from Atlantic Beach, Florida, and she is the narrator for the audiobook, An Affair with Beauty, The Mystique of Howard Chandler Christy, The Magic of Youth. Now, Pamela has many virtues. She is a 2016 Audio Award finalist. And as I mentioned, she has exceptional voice. And she's also a former pilot for Boeing 747. She used to fly for Northwest. So not only does she have the voice of a Christie girl, she's got the Christie girl persona. And today she is going to read an excerpt from the book.
Thank you. I gotta have these days too. Not when I was flying, but now I need it. And I will read a portion of the prologue of the book. I actually thought I printed it out. There, I did. I'm cheating. I can't do the 8-point even with my glasses. So I did print it out here. I thoroughly enjoy doing this. As Jim said, this is an interpretive biography. I sometimes hesitate with biographies because I think they're probably kind of dry and maybe boring. This fascinated me, and I really loved hearing the story of this artist who was such a legend in his own time, and I think will be, from the voice of his wife and muse, Nancy. So, without further delay, from the prologue, and as Jim says, for the rest of it, you're going to have to read the book, or get the audiobook from Audible, iTunes, or Amazon. Prologue. If I remember correctly, it was Sigmund Freud, the great German psychoanalyst, who once said that all artists want in life are three things: fame, money, and beautiful lovers. It was during the autumn of 1923 that I first heard this aphorism. as the sun slowly descended behind the city's jagged skyline of concrete and stone, I found myself milling about a crowded art gallery in midtown Manhattan. The main exhibition space swarmed with pearl necklaces and gold pocket watch chains. For the exhibiting artist, this was absolute splendor. The throng of prospective wealthy patrons meant success, a newfound clientele, new acquaintances, and of course, old friends. For me, the whole affair became a fantasy of elegance, spun with shimmering silk, painted chiffon, and violet georgette. As I left the main gallery, my attention was drawn to the exotic headdresses adorning two young women. Sheathed in crimson red and rust, they desperately wanted to appear like modern-day Egyptian princesses, perhaps distant cousins from those same royal bloodlines as Tutankhamun, the young pharaoh whose tomb was discovered the previous year. But somehow, with their fair complexions, they looked more like showgirls from Grauman's Egyptian theater in Hollywood. Close by, two tall enchantresses in flowing gowns of iridescent blue and royal purple hastily retreated from the crowd, only to fall victim to the idle plans of a pair of even taller gentlemen. Arms linked, they were off. Willowy gowns, some lavishly dripping with beads or metallic threads, swirled about that evening. The varied styles, patterns, and hem lengths all seemed lost in an ever-shifting sea of black dinner jackets. Dominating the scene then were high wing collars with a glistening gold button in front and a simple narrow bow of black satin below. White piqué shirts, as stiff as signboard, and tight black waistcoats transformed even the most modest gentleman into a debonair man of mystery like that of a movie star. As the people passed, I kept thinking, there goes Rudolph Valentino. Or, here comes Douglas Fairbanks. Wait, is that Mary Pickford? Who is that? Harry Houdini? Oh, he knows Howard and me. They all knew us. In fact, they were our close friends. It was all so difficult to avoid illusion then, when the entire room and its occupants glittered. Beauty reigned everywhere. Or so it seemed. This was the sublime sophistication of American prosperity during the early days of the Coolidge administration. Everything was magical then. The music seemed louder, the buildings seemed taller, and the cars seemed faster than I had ever known. The men and women seemed more daring. After what they had been through, no burden seemed too great. Invincibility filled the air. Diamond dust fell at their feet. And that is how it was on that October night when I met Emil Fuchs. Mr. Fuchs was an astute Austrian painter whom Queen Victoria and King Edward VII commissioned to paint the English royal family years earlier. Lean and somewhat gaunt, he had a distinctive aristocratic accent and a well-trimmed white beard. Knowing who I was and to whom I was married, he edged up beside me in his white tie and tails and furtively uttered those insightful words of Dr. Freud. Fame, fortune, and beautiful lovers, that is all art to swamped life. But I hope you'll enjoy the audiobook. And I can't wait for the second and third books because I'm ready to find out what happens too.
And they're coming soon. The second book will be out in 2018. The third book will be out in 2020. So it takes a little bit of time.
Oh!
Thank you so much for coming.
First of all, you're a terrific storyteller.
Thank you.
And the question is your desire to tell the story and the wonderful object which you found actually brought you to writing a book, or it was a different reason, or just knowing the subject brought you to write the book, and then you became a wonderful storyteller. This first.
I stumbled upon The Illustrators of Beauty in 1988. I was a freshman at the University of Maryland studying economics, and I was up in the stacks of the campus library one night, and I came across a very large folio, gilded edge folio. I pulled it down, and it said, The Social Ladder by Charles Dana Gibson. I opened it up, and I saw pen and ink illustrations in that book. And I thought to myself, wow, here is a man who is really talented. With pen and ink, he could turn paper into flesh. And for those of you who don't know Gibson was the premier illustrator of the 1890s, turn of the 20th century. He was a household name. The Gibson Girl was hugely popular. You know, Gibson Girl dresses and postcards and books, very similar to the Christy Girl. And I thought, wow, I'd love to know more about Gibson. And so that night I Xeroxed all the images in that book, and the next day I went back and got another folio of more drawings. Well, it took about 3 years before I stumbled upon Christy. I was in my local hometown of Rockville, Maryland, and I was in a Borders bookstore back in the days when they had bookstores. I was staring down at the bargain basement books, and I came across a book called America's Illustrators. It was first published in 1978 by Susan Meyer, republished in 1987. I thumbed through it, and there are 10 illustrators in that book, including Charles Dana Gibson, James Montgomery Flagg, another famous illustrator who gave us the I Won't Show Uncle Sam poster. There was Frederick Remington, Maxfield Parrish, the great Norman Rockwell. But the story that interested me the most was actually not one of them. It was the story of a once blind illustrator turned portrait painter. Until his dying day, he was known as the Barefoot Boy of the Blue Muskingum. And that man is Howard Chandler Christy. That story, in the few pages it was recounted, just amazed me. Because here's this man that grew up on a farm. A barefoot boy, the Blue Muskingum, running around in tattered clothes, and he became the most celebrated artist during the Jazz Age. And I thought, that is a real story. I'd love to write a book about that man. But it took many more years before I would. And at that point, it was 1991, there was no internet, I didn't have time for the research. I, of course, graduated from the University of Maryland, went to law school, went back to law school to get another degree. And now I practice law. I do estate planning and trust state litigation for the firm of Williams Mullen in McLean, Virginia. And during my spare time, I started writing the book in 2006. And to get to your question, part and parcel of that was the Christie Archives. Nancy was a consummate, she had sort of a hoarding problem. She kept everything that she could get her hands on with respect to Christie. And that was a great thing, because she loved that man so much, she wanted his story to be told. And eventually, those papers could have been lost, but eventually they made their way to Lafayette College in Easton, Pennsylvania, in the Skillman Library, where his archives are to this day. But at one point, they were in plastic bags, garbage bags, in the basement of a root cellar in Wayne Township, Pennsylvania. But they made their way to Lafayette College in 2000, and I knew when they did, because what was once a preoccupation became a huge obsession for me. I wanted to know everything there was to know about this man. So I made an inventory of what I needed, and I didn't make it to Lafayette College until 2006. And when I got there, I was just amazed at the information I found. Not only was the story true, it was better than I ever expected it would be. And again, Nancy kept all this information. She had 16 scrapbooks. And you go through the scrapbooks, and you just don't see one signature by Harry Houdini. You see five signatures, letters to Christy, begging him to come to an American Magicians Association meeting, or giving him tickets. And you see signatures by Amelia Earhart, the great Babe Ruth. You see signatures from, Teddy Roosevelt all the way through Truman. Christy's were great friends with Warren Harding and Florence Harding. They stayed at the White House many times, also great friends of Calvin and Grace Coolidge. They stayed at the White House many times, and many others. And so when I looked at this, I thought, this isn't just a story about an artist and his art. This is really a huge American story that's never been told before, and one that I think can change the way people think about art and think about history too, and also uncover little anecdotes and stories about some of these famous people we all know. Some are living legends, but do we all know them? Perhaps not. Are there stories? Perhaps not. I certainly don't know Christie's. Thank
you. Okay, so the great story of Christie's life brought out the writer in me.
It did, yes.
That's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but when you're done with a trilogy, do you see yourself as a writer who will continue, right, to find another object or subject what you want to discover and write about, or this is this isolated obsession, passion of yours, and when it's done, it's done?
As I tell people, you know, during my day, I spend time drafting motions and wills and trusts, and this is a whole lot more interesting than that. But after this is done, I would love to write a book about James Montgomery Flagg, who gave us the I Want You Uncle Sam poster, because here is another artist that was hugely famous. I would say he's sort of like the Tiger Woods of endorsers. He did more endorsements for products than perhaps any other artist during the time period. You know, from beer to watches to art supplies to aluminum insurance. And yet few people know who he was, but he had such a great persona. The story isn't quite as large as Christie's story, but it's a very poignant and compelling story.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I had a second question to you. What the hell happened? What happened? I mean, you're great. What?
Well, thank you. I was asked to do a National Tylenol commercial years ago for Northwest Airlines, or when I was a pilot, just because I was a female pilot. And after that, I did some regional spots for Northwest and did some narration of their videos and various things. And I did it sporadically for years. And then, because of health reasons, several hip replacements, I couldn't sit for long periods. I was flying international the whole time, and started doing it full time. Did a short medical retirement, and then I finally formally retired last year. I do miss it, but I am so blessed to have had two careers that I really have a passion for. And I love doing this. I've always loved reading, and to be able to bring great stories to life and channel Nancy over Christie.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
And all the other characters as well, too. Yes, please.
Well, your commitment is just astounding, you know, inspiring. I'm so curious, why haven't I heard about Christie? Why do you think he wasn't as iconic as his women weren't as iconic as the Gibson girl?
So the question is, why is Christie forgotten?
There
are three reasons, the first of which is this: modern art. It was so powerful, so compelling, that it left a lot of great American and European artists in its wake, completely forgotten. And we don't have to look back too far to look at some of the artists that were somewhat forgotten. Lewis Comfort Tiffany, when you think about Lewis Comfort Tiffany, why? He's remembered now. It wasn't so long ago he was forgotten. Bouguereau and many others. So that's number one. Number two is the Christie family never created a legacy for him, unlike Norman Rockwell's family or Maxfield Parrish's family. It's important for a family or other people to create a legacy around an artist, a foundation, something, so that he's remembered. Without that, he wasn't quite as remembered as he could have been. And I should say, his wife Nancy died in 1974, and she was upset that people forgot about Christie. She called him the forgotten man. She types out a memo sometime in the 1960s on Hotel des Artistes stationery, talking about how her frustration as to why he was forgotten and how he's become the forgotten man. How could we forget someone who was so patriotic, so well known during the time period? Of course, that memo gets tucked away in a file and eventually ends up in Lafayette College, and I stumble upon it. So that's really number two. And number three, no matter how famous you are, eventually you become forgotten.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well, that was a great comments you made. I have two questions. First one is, I heard a rumor that the artist had an illegitimate son who became the governor of New Jersey. Is there any truth to that?
Well, there is, he misspelled his name. With a Y, not I.
But more seriously, for somebody like Christy and N.C. Wyeth and Norman Rockwell, who I also understand lived here.
He did, right, in the 1920s and 1920s.
Could you sort of, what would those guys be doing today in the 21st century? Would there be this type of stuff you don't see so much anymore? But would they have adapted their art maybe to contemporary?
The illustrators and the illustrators of beauty came along at the perfect point in time. There was a short window of opportunity from the 1870s to about the 1940s where these talented men and women appeared on the scene and were able to capture the pulse of America through their artwork. One thing you don't see too much anymore, except for some extraordinary artists like Glenn Palmer Smith here, is talent. And these men and women had talent. And so that's a very good question as to what they would be doing nowadays, given that illustration isn't in need so much as it was back then, before the advent of photography, and of course before mass media. They probably would be website designers.
Hi, thank you for the plug. I wrote a book called The Murals of New York City for Reed Zoli a couple of years ago, and stumbled on Jim and all of his knowledge about Christy, and we became email friends and now fast friends. And everything that I learned about Christy was through the generosity of Jim, who just gave all of the information that I needed. Unfortunately, in my book, I had to boil it down. My editor cut me down to about 1,500 words because I could have gone on and on. It's such a rich, exciting, compelling story. Thank you for your kindness and generosity.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your book. It's a wonderful book. It came out in 2013. If you haven't seen it, it's called The Murals of the City of New York, and it covers these murals here, as well as the Rockefeller Center murals and many others. And wonderful illustrations, wonderful narrative. Highly recommend it.
And perfect companion piece to your book.
Thank you. That's right.
Hi,
Chandler. Yes.
Hi. I'm associated with the American Guild of Musical Artists, and we have been using a Howard Chandler Christy creation as our logo since 1936. However, we don't know much about how we got it or anything much about it, and wondered if you've come across our name through any of your research or certainly any record of this piece.
I'll show it to you, but I have not come across the name.
But it's been our logo since 36, and we're very proud of it and would love to know all we can about it.
I'll take a look at it.
Yeah.
You can't find out until book two.
I see.
Any other questions?
Is there a gentleman
in
the
corner? Yes, sir.
Do you have any other examples of Christy's art that's publicly available that you particularly recommend people seek out if they're interested in Christy's?
Public examples in...
Well, in either a setting like this or a museum, favorites, if you remember.
As I tell people, the Christie story is really sort of an American jigsaw puzzle. The pieces aren't in one place. It's scattered throughout the United States, and you can find his works in many different museums. As I mentioned earlier, the U.S. Capitol has 7 of his works, from the Senate dining room to the East stairwell of the U.S. Capitol. The White House has 3 of his works. The State Department has 1 of his works. The National Red Cross headquarters has 1 of his works as well, too. National Portrait Gallery has roughly 3 or 4 of his works. 1 is on display, portrait of Douglas MacArthur. I think the Met has 1 of his works, but it's not displayed. And then in different Capitol buildings throughout the United States, the Ohio State Capitol or State House has 2 of his very large works, the Tree of Greenville, as well as Dawn of a New Light with Thomas Alva Edison in its rotunda, and they have a portrait of Governor White as well. Ohio is very proud of Christy. Before we did the book signing here, the book launch, we did a pre-release out in Ohio, had three signings, and it was just fantastic. We had a lot of interest, and we had TV and radio and newspaper coverage as well. They love Christy. Yes, Pat.
Jim, are you still doing research?
My research is pretty much completed. Occasionally, the second book is done, by the way. The third book is half the way finished. And I imagine that there might be just a little bit more if I want to flesh out a detail or two in the book. There's one particular event in the 1930s during the midst of the Great Depression where, of course, Nancy and Howard are living here. Nancy gets angry at Howard, and I think it's because he has a new model coming in, Elise Ford here, and she goes down to Florida and stays in Palm Beach for a few days. And there's, well, to put make a long story short, she wanted to vent her anger at Howard, so she writes a letter to the New York Times gossip columnist to tell the world what a great time she's having down in Palm Beach. That's one piece I need for that letter that she writes to the gossip columnist. So there's a little bit more I need to do.
So what is your hometown now? Where do you live now?
I live in, or I should say, we live, that's my beautiful wife, Rita. It's her birthday today. And we live in Chantilly, Virginia, which is about 20 miles west of Washington, D.C. And we both work in Tysons Corner, Virginia, just a few miles west of Washington, D.C. She's my Christy girl, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Well, I'll be happy to sign more books if you have them, and thank you again for coming today.